Well, now on BBC Two, Tracy McLeod presents the music industry's prestigious annual award ceremony. We'd like to point out the programme contains strobe lighting effects.
Welcome to London's Grosvenor House Hotel, where in about three quarters of an hour, we'll be finding out who has won the fifth Mercury Music Prize for Best British and Irish Album of the Year. The prize's former winners are Primal Scream, Suede, M People and Portishead. But it's really the diverse shortlist of 10 albums of the year that the prize is intended to celebrate. This shortlist always moves fearlessly across the musical spectrum, and this year it includes albums from the jazz, classical and folk worlds, as well as Britpop, soul and progressive dance music. Mingling here tonight with the good, the bad and the ugly of the music industry are most of the shortlisted artists. And several of them, including Pulp, Courtney Pine, Norma Waterson and Mark Morrison, will be giving live performances here at the Grosvenor House. But first, let's run through the complete list of this year's contenders. The Mercury Music Prize 10 Albums of the Year. Pulp, Different Class. Oasis, What's the Story, Morning Glory. Norma Waterson, Norma Waterson. Underworld, Second Toughest in the Infants. Peter Maxwell Davis, The Beltane Fire. Manic Street Preachers, Everything Must Go. Courtney Pine, Modern Day Jazz Stories. Black Grape, It's Great When You're Straight, Yeah. War Child, Help. Mark Morrison, Return of the Mac. This year's 10 albums of the year, and in a moment we'll be hearing more from those albums, beginning with Oasis in full effect at Main Road, Manchester, earlier this year, and Pulp giving what they insist will be the first and last TV performance of Bar Italia from their Different Class album. I'll also be talking about the shortlisted albums with our specially assembled panel of critics. They are Tony Parsons, the Daily Mirror columnist and regular on Late Review, who could recently be seen in action interviewing Elton John in the warts and all rockumentary Tantrums and Tiaras. Laura Lee Davis, music editor of the London magazine Time Out, who last year served on the prize's panel of judges and only narrowly failed to persuade her peers to vote for her personal favourite, PJ Harvey. And DJ, author and record company boss Charlie Gillett, who has championed artists as diverse as Dire Straits and Jar Wobble. But now on with the albums. We begin with the two bands most strongly fancied to carry away this year's prize, Oasis and Pulp, you may have heard of them. First, performing live for the audience here at the Grosvenor House a little earlier this evening, Pulp.
Looking get me one. Two sugars would be great. 'Cause I'm fading fast, and it's nearly done. Oh, if they knock down this place, this place, it hurts to look much better than you. Oh, now move, move, quick, you gotta move. Come on, it's through. Come on, it's time. Oh, look at you, you looking so.
Oasis there from their homecoming gig at Manchester's Main Road, and before that, Pulp playing live here a little earlier tonight. Two formerly alternative bands who are well and truly in the mainstream this year. Let's start with Pulp and Tony Parsons. Tony, Pulp were nominated 2 years ago for His and Hers, and in the last year we've really seen them make that move from being an alternative band to being well in the mainstream. What is it about Different Class, this year's nominated album, that's allowed them to do that?
Well, I think Jarvis and his colleagues were, but especially Jarvis, was lovable 2 years ago. And he's a much more impressive figure than that now. He's emerged as a genuine working class hero, you know, not for the usual trite reasons that are turned out in rock and roll, that he's an angry young man. But his music's full of all the working class virtues, like humour, melancholy, and sentimental, and he's defiant. And he's the only man in rock music who could have come up with the line, "You can shove your year in Provence up your ass." He's a genuine working class hero.
Charlie Gillett, do you agree that Jarvis's persona is really the key to the success of Pulp's music?
Yeah, that's clear, but I'm surprised to hear Tony say working class. To me, he's the adolescent folk singer. You know, he goes inside and talks about the things that happen to us in our heads that most people are embarrassed or ashamed to actually bring out in the open. And he just kind of says, it doesn't matter, folks, and everybody loves him for that.
So the outsider.
the outsider.
Well, he's not the outsider, he's everybody. But it's what's inside him, and which I say normally stays there, out of sight.
Laura Lee Davis, we've seen two huge hits from the album, but is it more than just a collection of singles? So does it hang together as an album, as a whole?
I think musically and as a band, yes, it does work quite well, but I think those albums, those songs, Disco 2000 and Common People, became such anthems that really it sort of bred a bit of overfamiliarity, really. And when you get to other tracks on the album where they're singing about the same ideas and Jarvis is going on about being caught at it in the front room, you just think, oh, for goodness sake, can't you think of something else to sing about now? And for me, even though I really think that Pulp are great and I love the idea of talking about, like, seedy sex and sort of naive desire and things, it's all very cute, but I really think maybe it's time to move on for them. And I find this album generally a bit frustrating after a while.
Well, what about Oasis, Tony? I mean, last year we were sitting here talking about Blur versus Oasis. In the meantime, there's been a complete clean-up by Oasis. Yeah. What is it about this second album that's allowed them to sell 3 million copies?
Well, the second album got slagged off by everybody, and that's because critics and the public want different things. Critics want change. They expect it to be, you know, there's some developments on Definitely Maybe, and there really wasn't. Essentially, it was the same thing again, and the public like that. The public don't want change. Public like Definitely Maybe, and I think they've done enough and to be considered among the greats. You know, they've got a charismatic front man, they've got good tunes, they've got a fantastic image. You just find yourself thinking every now and again, you find yourself thinking, if only Noel Gallagher had read a couple of books. Yeah. If only he'd read a couple of books, they could have been so good.
Well, we've got an awful lot of acts to get through this evening, so we're going to leave Pulp and Oasis there and move on to a singer whose nominated album is her first solo release in a 32-year career at the forefront of British traditional music, Yorkshire's Norma Waterson. Her family group, the Watersons, were key artists in the 60s folk revival, and she's recently enjoyed further success with her husband Martin Carthy and their daughter Eliza in the Waterson-Carthy Trio. Here they are on the Grosvenor stage with the Fred Fisher standard, There Ain't No Sweet Man.
Although I may be alone, still
Norma Waterson playing at the ceremony earlier this evening with a band that includes her husband, Martin Carthy, and daughter, Eliza Carthy. Charlie Gillett, Norma Waterson, someone who's very closely associated with the British traditional music, but this isn't exactly a traditional album, is it?
No, I mean, I've never listened to her before, to tell you the truth, so this is a perfect kind of record for the Mercury Prize to introduce to a wider public. Recorded in Los Angeles, it's a beautiful sounding record. The first thing, before anything happens, you know, something about the first stroke of the guitar is brilliant. And in some ways, it's a Richard Thompson album, because he is the sort of musical star of it all the way through. He wrote one of the songs, Elvis Costello wrote one, Billy Bragg, and the first song is written by Jerry Garcia. It's very nice too.
Laura Lee, the voice is steeped in musical traditional experience, isn't it? How well do you think it accommodates all those different kinds of songwriter and song?
I think that the sort of authority of her experience really comes through on it, and I think her voice actually is very beautiful. But for her first solo album in all this time, in over 30 years, I think it's a bit of a shame that a lot of the time on the album there's too much music. For example, Billy Bragg's Since Swithin's Day, which is a very simple original, is kind of overworked on this album, which is a bit of a shame. I think it could have maybe been a bit more Spartan and a bit more just a celebration of songwriting.
So you would like to be more folk rather than less folk?
Yeah, I mean, there are some blue, you know, really beautiful blue moments, like a cover of an Elvis Costello song and whatever, but I think sometimes it's all a bit too cosy and warm and familiar. I think it would be nice if maybe it had just been her voice, which is fantastic, just much more simple.
Tony, Charlie says this is a perfect Mercury Music Prize album. Do you think it's an album that's likely to cross over to a wider public after the exposure it's had here?
Well, to me it remains a folk album, although you've got songs by Billy Bragg and Elvis Costello and Jerry Garcia and Richard Thompson. To me, because of her voice, it doesn't broaden her base as these guys stuffing their fat faces behind us say. It remains a folk album because of her voice, because her voice is so steeped in the folk tradition. And in the end, I mean, you come down to the Neil Young conundrum. What do you think of the voice? Do you like the voice? Does the voice move you? And I have to say, although she's clearly in her field, she's a grandmaster, I have to say that I don't like it.
Okay, well, we'll leave Norma Waterson there and take a look at two vastly different albums of mainly instrumental music, which could only really rub shoulders at the Mercury Music Prize. In a moment, we'll be taking a rapidly blinking look at Underworld, whose adventurous blend of techno, ambient and progressive dance music on Second Toughest in the Infants has found favour with rock as well as dance fans. But first, we'll hear a brief extract from Sir Peter Maxwell Davis's The Beltane Fire, originally composed for a ballet that never happened, about the conflict between the Reformation clergy Underworld, and before that, an extract from Sir Peter Maxwell Davis's The Beltane Fire. Laura Lee Davis, both these, let's start with Peter Maxwell Davis, both of the pieces differently with the surreal punk funk of Black Grape, and their debut album, It's Great When You're Straight, yeah. Wales's manic street preachers survived the disappearance of lyricist and driving spirit Richie Edwards to deliver their most successful and most stirring work to date, Everything Must Go. Here they both are in brief extracts from their performances on BBC Two's live music show, Later with Jules Holland.
Yeah.
Black Grape and Manic Street Preachers, both giving it loads on later. Tony Parsons, Sean Ryder has led two hugely successful groups, first Happy Mondays and now Black Grape. But he's not exactly what you'd call a singer's singer, is he?
He's not a singer's singer, but I think he's revealed on this record as a lyricist of mad babbling genius. You know, the man's the Bob Dylan of Salford. And this is actually the greatest comeback record of all time. The fact that the guy's alive is remarkable. The fact that he can make it down to Grosvenor House is incredible. That he can come back with a record this good is really heartening. I mean, it's an absolutely fantastic record. And it presents like Sean Ryder's coherent view of the universe. And he sounds completely and totally unrepentant. It's a fantastic record.
Charlie, I understand you hadn't really heard the Black Grape album before we asked you to listen to it. Was it a discovery for you?
It totally was, and it's basically the revelation of the 10 records, really. And I think it must be a great credit to the producers, Danny Faber and Steve Lerone, I think he's called, who've pulled the madness that Tony's talking about together. It reminds me, actually, of Ian Dury's first album, New Boots and Panties, which had a similar history, that Ian was, everybody knew, a brilliant, genius kind of guy, but what did you do with him? In that case, putting together with Chas Jankel here, this combination's great.
Well, what it also has in common with Ian Dury's first album is that this is a kind of British funk that, when we were normally, Britain is not very good at being funky, but...
The real northern soul.
They seem to have invented a new kind of British funk, haven't they, Laura Lee?
Yeah, definitely, and also, I mean, with some sort of great rock rhythms in there as well, and like you say, some great lyrics. I mean, anybody can get away with Shake Well before opening, and make it sound cool and groovy,
and it's,
you know,
frothy,
a
man.
Work of genius, and like real 90s lad rock without all the sort of loaded rubbish that
it
usually goes
sound
with
like
it.
A lot of records these days sound as though they're sitting around with their John Lennon compilations and their T-Rex anthologies, and this doesn't actually sound like that. It really sounds like it's appeared from nowhere.
Talking Heads, it reminded me of Every Now and Then.
Let's move on to the Manics. They've really had to completely reinvent themselves after the disappearance of Richie Edwards. What kind of band have they come back as?
I think they've really softened. I mean, obviously when they started they were, hey, punk spirit, you know, we're going to retire after our first album, make millions and never come back. You know, several albums down the line they've sort of discovered a very kind of LA rock style, really. They've always, I think, been over-romanticised in the press over here, partly because they're a British band. They've got the sort of American rock sort of style, but they've got a certain credibility as well and a seriousness that you don't usually get in British rock bands. So they can kind of balance the two and give people something that's quite sort of glamorous but also quite heartfelt, really.
Tony, how much is this album coloured by the disappearance of Richie Edwards?
Well, I think it's coloured completely by it, but the great irony is I think it's the best thing they've ever done, because I think they've